Hi, Omar Yusuf here, and today we're gonna talk about science and shit. Hopefully, you're interested because look at this sexy whiteboard. Come on. If you wanna see more science videos like this, make sure to like the damn video. I'm back with some of these. This is the OG whiteboard. I think it actually predates Athlene X. It may even predate the dinosaurs, but not Scooby 1961. I want to give a shout out before I begin. We're going to be talking about the effects of cortisol or being too stressed, high stress, chronic stress when it comes to weight loss. That actually can make you fatter, stress, and not in the way probably that you think. Or alternatively, the title can be how chronically elevated levels of cortisol can make you lose muscle mass. And all this is true and probably not in the way that you think. I have to give a quick shout out to Eric Trexler, who we had on the podcast recently, and the Stronger by Science crew for this chart. He has a fantastic article. It'll probably take you about 40 minutes to read, all about something called metabolic adaptation. This is a small snippet, but I want to talk today about trying to maximize weight loss and how having chronically elevated levels of cortisol is terrible in order to have a jacked physique. And I'll break this down. We have six different hormones here. You've probably heard this before. When someone's like, oh man, I'm trying to lose weight and it's tough. And someone's like, yo man, don't be a bitch. Like, it's all in your head. Like, get to the gym. And they're right, probably not in the way that they think, because it's true. It is all in your head. Your hypothalamus, actually, where your leptin. Leptin is a hormone. It sends a signal to a portion of your hypothalamus that lets you know what, man? I'm good. I don't need to eat any more food. When your fat cells are satiated, when they have enough carbohydrates, essentially when you consume enough carbohydrates, your leptin levels are high, and so it sends a signal along with ghrelin to your body, where you want that one to be down actually, sends a signal to your body to say, you know what, he's good or she's good, they don't need to eat. But when you begin to lose weight, it actually kind of wreaks havoc on your body. And when I said before that it's all in your brain, I mean it. I think people underestimate the impact of your hormones when it comes to your body composition. So much so that I was talking with Eric Trexler on the podcast, and he was saying how they did a study with some mice, and what they did, there was ablation, which means essentially that they burned some parts of the brain in order to test out what happens if, and I believe it was leptin, if they remove it completely. So it's down regulated, which means the rat would be insatiable, right? They would want to keep eating. And then alternatively, they had someone, and I think they had it where their leptin levels were jacked up, where they're full all the time, tested out. But the person or the rat that had no leptin whatsoever, so it's down regulated, so your body's just always hungry, it ate itself to death. And then the other rat that was, you know, had really high leptin and they kept it there, it was never hungry and actually starved to death. So when we talk about the role of hormones with weight loss, it's very important. And even though we're talking mainly about cortisol today, we have all these six up here because they influence one another. Leptin influences cortisol, it also influences testosterone. There's a lot of things going on at once. So I don't just want to talk about cortisol, but let's first talk about the effects of weight loss on your hormones, and let's dial it back then to someone who is chronically stressed out, which is most modern people in one way or another. You know, maybe you're stressed out from your job, maybe you're stressed out when it comes to your education, your relationships, maybe you don't get good sleep. I'm gonna talk about strategies to mitigate the effects of elevated cortisol and how to have a more anabolic environment for your body. Let's first just talk about weight loss though. So let's say you want to lose weight, congratulations. And you begin to, well, immediately, even before you actually start to lose a lot of fat, what happens to leptin, it downregulates because your body, your fat cells, as soon as you start reducing carbohydrates, that's the primary one that'll influence leptin. It tells your body, you know what, you're hungry. And that's why you're hungry. Even before you start losing a lot of weight, you get hungry, right? And then what ends up happening over time is that it affects numerous hormones. It also reduces your metabolic rate. And so they've noted their physique competitors, after they went from wherever they started to competing, if you don't do this right, or if you're that stressed out, or it's just not a conducive environment, they've found studies of individuals losing 10 pounds of lean muscle mass. And that's crazy. Imagine losing 10 pounds of your lean muscle mass when you're just trying to get into contest shape or look really, really good. So getting this right is very important. Anyway, so we have these, we have thyroid, we have insulin, we have testosterone. Well, the role of testosterone post-exercise is not nearly as important as people were putting forth before. Your resting levels of testosterone are. They determine how fast or how much you could synthesize a new muscle mass and how much muscle mass you hold on at rest. This, when you start dieting, you diet for a long period of time. So I'm talking people getting super lean, your testosterone levels also plummet. This is just not looking good, right? Which is why, as you continue to lose weight, you need to be smart about it. And training is a stress. That's why when I talk about cortisol, training is a stress, reducing the amount of calories you eat is a stress, not getting enough sleep, these are all stress factors. And so managing your total load, managing the amount of cardiovascular work that you do, sometimes there is that dose-response relationship where if you train too much, it actually could, especially when you're in a caloric deficit, it could be detrimental towards your physique. And so you need to manage the load that you're lifting, the total volume that you're attempting to handle when you train, and then also even cardio, because people think, oh, cardio, I'll lose some weight. It can wreak havoc right here. And I'll have, if you guys are interested, I'll leave a comment below. I wanna have Eric Trexler on for multiple reasons, but we could talk about the role of cardio and fat loss. Anyways, cortisol levels. So when cortisol, and I wanna stress too that cortisol isn't all bad. We're actually in the morning, it's important, it helps you wake up. But in this context of what we're talking about for weight loss, chronically, I keep saying chronically, elevated levels of cortisol are bad. And so I'll give you four reasons right here. It blunts leptin activity. So already when you're losing weight, when you're reducing your carbohydrate consumption, leptin is down. When leptin is down, you get hungrier. But even worse, when you're more stressed out, when cortisol is elevated, it reduces the bioavailability of your leptin level. So already they're down like this, but then from what you got, you can't even use it, and so you're hungrier. And this leads you to wanting to eat more palatable foods, foods that taste better. So that's why do you think when cortisol is elevated, you're stressed out? It's like, man, I wanna eat a pizza. That's why you wanna eat a pizza. So managing this is essential for weight loss, and this influences that, and then conversely, this can also influence this. Water retention is something that doesn't get talked about enough, and that is the scale might not be budging and this stresses you out, but actually what's happening is that your body's just maintaining water and it keeps maintaining the water that you have. So you might be 180 pounds, you might be losing weight, you actually might be losing fat mass, you might lose 2 pounds, but because you're holding on to water, you look the exact same. And so that stresses you out even more. Okay. And then lastly, when I talked about the role of chronically elevated levels of cortisol, it could induce protein breakdown. So it could lead to losing lean muscle mass. And that's the worst. That's how essentially cortisol can make you fatter. How? Well, one, in the first place, if you're just in a bad environment, you're super stressed out, you wanna eat more food, right? This is gonna downregulate right here, makes you hungrier, makes you wanna crave more palatable foods, you're ordering that McDonald's, you're getting that pizza. So it can make you fatter. But it can also make you lose muscle mass, once again, by inducing protein breakdown where it's chronically elevated, by also making you crave those palatable foods. Water retention where you don't know that you're losing weight because the scale's not budging, and this happens very often, especially when you get further along in weight loss and you're only losing 0.5, 0.8 pounds per week, but it's not budging because you're holding on to that water. It creates that perfect environment. I hope I've explored or really explained the role of cortisol when it comes to weight loss. The question then becomes the practical side, what do we do about this? We wanna lose weight. And recently I said that before, I lost over 3 weeks, 7.5 pounds, felt great. If you're starting off in your weight loss journey, it shouldn't get too bad. As you get leaner and leaner, it gets harder and harder. And the more stressed out you are, the worse it is to lose weight, which is why it's not an anabolic environment when you're just very stressed out. I don't recommend extreme weight loss or trying to get super jacked if you're not feeling optimal. And so you should address that first. But let's answer the question, how do we fix this? How do we fix the stress? How do we fix the cortisol? In the first place, if you're dieting heavy, having a refeed where you consume more carbohydrates in order to positively impact your leptin levels is a very good idea. And that's why every 2 weeks, it depends upon your diet, eating 100 to 200 grams more of carbs on a refeed day is a very good idea. Remember, while it's calories in, calories out, it's a lot more complicated than most people realize. And you'd be shocked if you found out how little calories calories essentially someone will eat near the end of their contest prep, because it's not just calories in, calories out, as people normally think. So having a refeed every few weeks will help with the leptin levels. Having diet breaks, and that's something that I'm currently experimenting with, because spoiler, Severin, I'm gonna say it, there's something to do with the gym in the future, it's been going down. It's stressful, so it's not the best environment. I still wanna look better, and I've lost those 7 pounds. As such, there is no negative consequence towards taking a diet break and eating at maintenance, other than slightly extending your weight loss journey. But taking a diet break will help reset some of these hormones, especially if you've been dieting for a period of time. So maybe you do 3 weeks on, 2 weeks off, or 3 weeks off, or 4 weeks on, 2 weeks off, whatever you're comfortable with, whatever leads to your highest level of compliance and adherence is what you should do. But diet breaks can really help with those hormones, especially if you're not competing, if you're not doing a physique or bodybuilding show. So increasing carbohydrates, making sure that they're not too low in the first place, and that you're refeeding over time, so every 2 weeks, consuming more carbohydrates, good to go. Consider taking dietary breaks. Manage the impact of cardio when it comes to your training. For most people, because you're already busting your ass in the gym, you wanna make sure that you increase your NEAT, which means walking around more, fidgeting, doing activity outside of the gym. If you're doing high intensity interval training, it's really gonna drain you, it's gonna affect your performance in the gym. If you walk more, you will expend a lot more calories, but it won't cause more stress on your body. So you wanna make sure you're doing the right things, especially the further along you get into your weight loss journey. Remember, more is not always necessarily better, despite what Yngwie Malmsteen said.
How could less be more? It's impossible. More is more.
Moving forward from that, managing your stress is outside of the scope of this video, but know that chronic stress is just really bad for you trying to lose weight. I know people are probably thinking, yeah, man, I want to lose weight, and now you're stressing me out because I'm stressed, and I'm just going to be stressed more about being stressed, and it's just going to make me, you know, get fatter. Yeah, deal with it. I want to say that sleep is one of the best things that you can do, honestly, really and truly. And that's why sleep hygiene, they refer to it as making sure that it's a dark room, making sure that it's a cool room, making sure you read before bed, you ignore your phone so you're not on your phone constantly before bed, you get a blue light blocker, in order to make sure that it's just a good environment for sleep. You sleep and you sleep soundly, because especially as you continue to diet, cortisol is gonna be elevated, which means you're going to want to wake up, you're gonna have a hard time falling asleep. But sleep is one of the best things that you can do. I also want to talk briefly about meditation, and it's not some hokey word, but taking some time out for yourself every single day to refocus, balance, and get what's right, and make sure you're of a sound state of mind, I personally find, and a lot of people find, helpful. Just taking a few minutes to yourself. So sleep, managing the stress, meditation, focusing on the right forms of cardio. Also, taking a look at your training program. If you're training 6 times a week and now you're in a caloric deficit, maybe 6 times a week is not the answer. Maybe the volume you're handling before when you're previously gaining weight is not what you want to do. So make sure you also take a look at your training program and that it's the right level of volume. It's not too much. You need a minimum amount, the minimum effective volume, of course, to grow, but you don't want to overshoot that and just end up breaking down your body. I hope that explained the role of cortisol, the role of stress when it comes to weight loss, and how it really can negatively impact things, how it can make you get fatter, how it can make you lose muscle mass, and how these things, even if you're doing the right things, how if you're not managing these variables or variables outside of the gym, it really can screw with you and make you not have the physique that you deserve. Anyways, I wanna get out of here. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed these videos, if you're like, man, I love those whiteboard videos from 2012, 2013, 2014, 2015, leave a comment below what you wanna see next. Also, if you know Eric Trexler, he's fantastic, leave a comment with what you want him to talk about on this channel. Thank you so much for watching this video. I'll see all you guys, my rascals. Remember, it is all in your brain, in that next video. Peace.
Eat your vegetables, eat your vegetables, eat your fucking vegetables.